This week, we're going to be talking about reflashing. Now, maybe you've heard that term and maybe you've wondered what it means. Well, we're going to find out exactly what's involved with reflashing on our version 11 Subaru STi. So let's jump in. The Subaru STi, the various generations of this car, pretty popular out there in the tuning market, and there are plenty of options when it comes to how to modify your tune. Obviously, one of the key ones is to simply replace the factory ECU with a full aftermarket standalone, and there's options there from a range of different manufacturers. Nothing wrong with that. It gives you great control, particularly some motorsport features that sometimes you can't incorporate easily with a stock ECU. Downside though is they're going to be pretty costly, and depending what brand you're going with, it could be anywhere from $1,000 or $1,500 US up to well over $3,000, plus then you've got to actually pay for the cost of the tune, so it can be pretty significant. One of the options that I'm a big fan of is actually reflashing the factory ECU. So this technique allows us to basically download all of the stock calibration information out of the ECU. We can then display it graphically in a way that makes sense to us as tuners, and then we can manipulate it and modify it to suit basically the same way that the factory calibration engineers do this. Anyway, let's jump in. We're going to talk about this car a little bit. It's very lightly modified, so not too much to talk about, and then we'll have a look at the software and see how we're actually going about it. So the car itself, as I said, not really particularly modified. The engine itself is completely stock. We have upgraded the turbocharger, and that was through necessity rather than anything else. So turbo sitting down in there, it's a little hard to see. It's a Kinagawa direct replacement turbocharger. Now, because we're here in New Zealand, we generally get the Japanese domestic market model. So this runs the 2-litre engine. It has quad variable cam control. And in stock form, the version 11 also uses a split pulse exhaust manifold. So the Kinagawa is a direct fit that retains the split pulse exhaust housing. Definitely laggier than stock. And also, at the moment, we really can't utilize the full benefit of that turbo because we've got a stock fuel system. Let's jump back in. The other aspect, which is a little bit hard to see here, is we have got a 3-inch turbo back exhaust system just to basically make everything a little bit more free-flowing. Obviously, still got the stock top mount intercooler as well. And as I mentioned, stock injectors and stock fuel pump. And at the moment, we've basically got that whole fuel system pretty well tapped. Anyway, let's have a quick look at the Dyno screen, laptop screen, and we'll also talk about what we're using here to read and write to the ECU. Right, for a start, when you're looking at your options in the open source world, there are actually quite a few, obviously dependent on the vehicle, and it's really important to mention that there is unfortunately no one-size-fits-all tool that you can use on every car. So it is really a case of looking at what's available and what people are commonly using for the car that you want to tune. Obviously here we're talking about Subaru, and this is probably one of the more popular cars for modification in the open source tuning world, so our options are pretty wide here. The commonly available options include EcuFlash, which is what we're going to be looking at today. There's also RomRaider, which we're actually going to be using for the logging side of things, so we'll go over that as well. And then there is also a relatively low cost option from EpiFan, which is EcuEdit. None of these tools are overly expensive. Some have better options than others. There's pros and cons with all of them, but essentially they're all doing the same thing, so regardless which one you're using, it's all going to look relatively similar. And that's because the maps and parameters that we've got available to change are defined by what's inside of the ECU, not actually the software that we're using. So while the menu structure might look a little bit different, basically everything we're going to be modifying is exactly the same. Now, before you can actually read and write from your ECU, you're going to need a hardware interface. So for this, we're using the Tactrixs OpenPort 2.0. Is that what it is? Yes, it is. Pretty commonly available, very, very popular. You're going to be looking at around about maybe $200 US for this. And also, depending on the particular model of Subaru you want to reflash, there are a couple of reflashing connectors as well that you need to use just to bridge a connector that basically puts the ECU into reflash mode. In the version 11, that's nice and easy. There's just a green 2-pin connector that's factory fitted down by the ECU. We just need to connect that when we're reading or writing to the ECU. So basically, that's your entire cost if you're going to be using one of the freely available packages. Now let's jump into the software and see what that actually looks like. So this is what we see. This is what's available inside the EcuFlash software. So let's have a quick look at how this all works. So we've got a menu structure over here on the left-hand side with basically all of the available tables that we can make adjustments to. So we've got our boost control here. We'll open that up and we can see if we click on our boost target table, this is the target boost pressure that the stock ECU is programmed to run. So we can see that set to run around about 19 psi through the peak torque area of the map. We've got our axes here of engine RPM, and we've also got requested torque from the ECU as the load axis. Let's jump down to something that's probably a little bit more familiar to some people. We'll look at our fueling. So this is how we can control the fueling in the EcuFlash software. We'll open that. There's a couple of tables here that are important, but the main one we're going to be focusing on is our primary open loop fueling. We'll open that up. You can also view this in a graphical form as well, so you've got a better idea of the sort of general shape and trends inside of that stock table. So again, three-dimensional RPM on the vertical axis. We've got engine load in terms of grams per revolution on the horizontal axis. And that grams per revolution is something that a lot of tuners, even experienced tuners, don't really understand, particularly if you've come from an aftermarket tuning world. Then generally most of our aftermarket standalone ECUs don't use a mass airflow sensor. Instead they work on the speed density principle, and they are simply looking at manifold absolute pressure on that load axis. So using a mass airflow sensor is pretty common with most factory ECUs, definitely not all, but the difference is that that mass airflow sensor directly measures the mass of air entering the engine. And why that's important is that if the ECU accurately knows the mass of air entering the engine, and it's also got some other tables that define the injector size that's fitted to it, then it's really easy for the ECU to calculate what sort of pulse width to deliver to the injectors in order to get a specific air fuel ratio. And that's again why we see that this fueling table here simply defines our target air fuel ratios. Now, let's have a quick look back in the engine bay and we'll see where that information comes from. So this little guy here on the intake system, it's actually attached to the factory airbox. This is the mass airflow sensor. So again, all of the air entering the engine goes through this mass airflow sensor, and it outputs a voltage to the ECU that is simply a 0 to 5 volt output. And inside the ECU, there's another table that converts that voltage into a mass airflow in grams per second. So that's a really big key to the whole tuning process when we are tuning a factory ECU. Let's jump back into the EcuFlash software and we'll see what that looks like. All right, so let's just close down our open loop fueling target table for a moment. What we're going to do is come down here to our mass airflow and we'll have a look at our mass sensor scaling. So what we can see here is we've got this simple two-dimensional table. Let's bring up a graphical view though, just so it makes a little bit more sense. And here the axis is our mass airflow sensor voltage. So again, this is the voltage being delivered by the airflow meter. And then the table here is going to convert that into a mass airflow number in terms of grams per second. Now I know that a lot of tuners are scared off by a mass airflow sensor because primarily I don't think they understand it properly. And when we do understand it, it's actually really simple. So instead of going to the complexity of needlessly swapping to a speed density operating system, if we can retain the mass airflow sensor, we're not exceeding its flow capabilities, then often this will actually speed up the tuning process. And why that's the case is that once that mass airflow sensor scaling is set correct, all we do is ask for the air fuel ratio we want. That's what we're going to get. So the next obvious question is, how do we rescale the mass airflow sensor? How do we make sure that that table that we just looked at is accurate? It's actually quite easy. All we're going to do is look at the air fuel ratio that the ECU is asking for. And we just saw that in the primary open loop air fuel ratio target table. We're going to compare that to the measured air fuel ratio coming from a wideband air fuel ratio sensor fitted to the exhaust. Now to make our lives a little bit easier, Subaru actually fit a wideband front O2 sensor to this car. does need to be treated with a little bit of care. While yes, it is a wideband sensor, Subaru only use that still at or relatively close to the stoichiometric air-fuel ratio, meaning that it is a little bit inaccurate if you want to use that at high boost. It generally tends to read a little bit richer than the actual air-fuel ratio. It's okay though, we've fitted an external wideband sensor and we're bringing that into our ECU as well. So, now let's have a look at what we're doing with that information in order to read it. This is our second software package here. This is RomRaider, and a lot of people do use this for editing as well. So let's just have a quick look here. We'll open up the same table that we just looked at, and no big surprises there. It looks the same, different pretty colors, but essentially exactly the same table. But I'm only using this here for the logging side of things. So we'll have a look at this now. Now the logger is an essential part of reflashing because we need to be able to run the car and then know what the ECU is actually doing, what the inputs and outputs to the ECU were, so that we know what we need to change. So here we've got a range of parameters that I am logging. You might think that given this large list of parameters here that we have available, the easiest solution would be to just log them all. And while that might sound like a good idea, in reality, what that's going to do is end up with a very, very slow logging rate that's basically useless to us. So we want to be very careful and only pick the parameters that we actually need. Have a quick look in here at what we've got. So we are looking at a couple of air fuel corrections. So this tells us what the ECU is doing in closed loop mode to correct the air fuel ratio. We've also got our manifold pressure. We've got a wideband innovate lambda sensor coming in here. So that's our actual air fuel ratio. And then we've got some other aspects here that helps us scale that mass airflow sensor, in particular our mass airflow sensor voltage and our mass airflow sensor reading the output in grams per second. So that's enough to actually help us with the mass airflow sensor scaling. Of course, now we also need to have a way of displaying all of that information. So here's where we're using another software package. Don't get scared off, it's still pretty straightforward and it's still incredibly cheap. There is a small cost involved with this, but we're using Mega Log Viewer HD, so let's jump in and have a quick look at that. So this is what we've got from a ramp run on the dyno here. I'm not going to go into too much detail because there's obviously a fair bit of information up there on the screen, but at the top here we've got our RPM. We can see our ramp run there that we performed on the dyno. I've got some parameters in here that actually let us monitor the knock activity from the factory ECU, and that's really important. We want to make sure anytime we are tuning that the ECU is not detecting any knock. We've actually got a little bit going on in here, and we can see at this particular point here our feedback knock correction is pulling out 1.4 degrees of timing. So if that was repeatable, definitely something that we'd want to deal with. This next group of parameters here is what we're really interested in though. We're looking here at our final fueling base. This is the green parameter. It's a straight line, pretty straightforward here. So this is our target air fuel ratio. Just for the purposes of scaling the mass airflow sensor, we'd set this to an across the board 11.6 to 1 air fuel ratio. The red parameter that we can see here, this is our measured air fuel ratio from our wideband. So you can see that we're pretty close as we click through. We're pretty close, but there's a little bit of error, particularly down here in the lower RPM range. And that yellow parameter that I've added in there, that gives us a direct indication of what the error is, so how much fuel we need to add or remove. And we are going to then basically make those changes into our mass airflow sensor scaling to correct it. So what's it all look like when we've got it right? Well, we're still in the process here, but on our dyno screen, we've got a couple of runs up. And first of all, in blue, this is our factory run. So this is in stock form. Well, I mean, as close to stock as we can get it, given that we already had the larger exhaust and turbo. So we're laying down 297.1 horsepower at the wheels. And we can see our yellow run there, which is with our modified calibration. We've still got a little bit of work ahead of us, but we're getting pretty close to having that finalized. And we can see at that particular point there, we're 317, 318 horsepower almost at the wheels. So pretty big improvement in terms of peak power. What's actually more impressive though, if we click over here right at the top of the run, we can see that we've gone from basically 270 horsepower to 310 horsepower. So we're about a 28 horsepower improvement, which is something you're definitely going to feel. So the next obvious question is, how did we end up picking up almost 30 horsepower at the top end there? And a lot of this is actually just fixing the excessive, overly rich factory tune. So our next plot down here, this is our air fuel ratio. So we can see our blue run here, 10.47 to 1. So 10.5 to 1 air fuel ratio target from factory, which is ridiculously rich. We do need some additional fuel for cooling and keeping the engine reliable, but 10.5 to 1 is just costing us power. That is ridiculous. So we've leaned that out to, as you can see there, 11.8 to 1. So that's actually where a lot of our power gains come from. There's also a little bit more timing has gone into there as well. The thing to keep in mind here is that we're actually only running around about 14 psi peak boost there at high RPM. And we've done this purposely. We've kept that boost down low because we are at the absolute limit of the fuel injectors and the fuel system. So if we have a look at our boost curves over here, our yellow curve obviously is our modified curve. We've got the boost coming in a little bit earlier. Now, I'll just explain that as well before someone jumps in and asks how we got so much more boost response. The reason for this is that the Subaru engine, because the exhaust manifold runners are so long, it really does take a couple of runs to get heat into the exhaust manifold, into the exhaust housing, and get that boost response up. So that blue run that we did in stock form isn't actually too representative of the low RPM response, because basically it was one run, we didn't have everything really up to temperature. So we would have expected pretty much similar results to the yellow run there. So if we click over here though, we can see what our peak boost is, which is just over about 20 psi, about 21 psi. We've got that dropping off, and then we do see that we are running a little bit more boost in the top end. We're running just on 14 psi with our modified calibration versus just a touch over 13 psi with the stock calibration. So fueling, timing, just a touch more boost. But of course, if we added bigger injectors and a larger fuel pump to this combination, then that would really open us up to increase the boost, hold that boost through the rev range, and we're going to end up making huge increases in power there. So there you go, that's just one of the solutions that is available in terms of optimizing your tune. Now, everything I'm showing you here, we've got set up at the moment because we are in the middle of filming a worked example for our practical reflash tuning course. So for those of you who do want to learn a little bit more about the ins and outs of reflashing using open source, that's going to be perfect for you. Our reflashing course teaches you essentially everything you need to know about reflashing basically any engine using both open source and commercial reflashing packages. And the worked example is an informal walkthrough of a six-step process that we've put together. And by following that process through, make sure that you tick all of the boxes, you don't overlook any critical steps, and you're going to get the best results, most importantly, ensuring that you're getting great results with good reliability. So if you are interested in learning more, that's going to be added into our practical reflash tuning course. Should be out in the next few weeks, and you can find that at hpacademy.com/courses. Thanks for watching, and if you like that video, please make sure you give us a thumbs up, subscribe if you haven't already, and if you've got any questions, you can ask those in the comments. Next week, we're going to be covering our blowing up 3U ZFE engine. It's got a massive hole in the side of the block where it certainly shouldn't have. We're also going to be doing an update on our FD RX7 project car.